Go ahead. Shalom, shalom. Teacher Judea here at One Nation Israelite School, also known as Prince Yizzy.
Shalom, Officer Solomon here at the One Nation Israelite School.
Now we are
One Nation Israelite School.
And thanks for joining us in another edition of Real Talk, where we go over different topics and we show who we are on and off the camera. We just keep it real. So, today's class is entitled Strifeful. Alright. With that being said, we're going to jump into it. So, I hope everybody had a good Sabbath. And I hope the start of the week is kicked off on a high note. You know, it ain't never the same when it ain't the Sabbath. But, hey, it is what it is. We gotta make it. We gotta make it to the Sabbath, though. You know what I'm saying? So I'm gonna pass it over to brethren. But let's start off with school slogan. Let's go to St. Luke chapter 2, verse 49.
Luke chapter 2, verse 49. And he said unto them, "How is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my Father's business?
So Christ was telling his own mother and his own father in the flesh that he must be about his Father's business. Likewise with us, when we come to this truth, it's no longer time to sit around. Once you start figuring out who you are and what we got to do to get out of this captivity, it's your job to go out to the lost sheep and push that doctrine to help us get up out of this captivity. Alright? So, that being said, let's go to Zephaniah 2 and 1. Come over, son.
Zephaniah chapter 2 and verse 1. Gather yourselves together. Yea, gather yourselves together, O nation not desired.
Scripture said, do what now? Gather yourselves together, O nation not desired. We are that nation that is not desired. So who is it telling to come together? It's telling us, the nation, to come together.
Yeah.
So, like we were saying earlier, we got a class called Zephaniah 2 and 1. Go check it out. It breaks it all down for those who may not be all up to speed or who may want to strife about the way the scripture has been brought out. The scriptures say, gather yourselves together. Yea, gather yourselves together, O nation that is not desired.
Uh-huh.
That is us. So it is telling us to gather ourselves together. Come back to the law, statutes, and commandments of the Most High God. Alright? So with that, sick of all the strife, man. I'm sick of brothers want to go back and forth. Brothers want to argue. Why we brothers can't? I'm going to let you open up because you got the, I hope you got a remedy for why a lot of strife and arguments and stuff start up.
Let's hope these scriptures be remedied, because a lot of brothers just, they don't want to hear it, man. They just so content and so into strife. They don't ever want to live at peace with their own brethren. But they so quick to say, let's have peace with Esau and the other nations. You cannot do that. It starts at home first. It starts in our nation first. We have to have peace here first with each other. But we don't, because we got too much hatred, strife, and continue going back and forth with each other. And you know, let's open up with James 1:19, because that's another problem too. Brothers so cool, they don't want to listen, but they got all the answers. So understand that.
James 1:19.
Uh-huh.
James 1:19. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath.
See, that's what starts confusion and conflict. It's when a brother or sister have a problem with listening, which brings forth wrath, which leads into strife.
You know what? The point that you made, brothers have a problem with listening.
They do.
We, us, the nation of Israel, we have a bad habit of, we don't even hear what a brother's saying. We so quick to make a response instead of listening.
Yeah.
Listen first. Know what you responded to. But we cut each other off. We'll cut it. He can't finish his statement. I'll cut him off.
Yeah.
I can't finish my statement. He cut me off. Give me Sirach real quick. That's the problem right there. That's where a lot of strife and envy and fighting started. Everybody want to talk. Nobody want to listen.
Yeah.
Sirach 11 and 8.
Sirach chapter 11 and verse 8. Answer not before thou hast heard the cause.
So how are you going to respond to something if you ain't even heard the cause? The scriptures say, answer not until thou hast heard the cause. Come on.
Neither interrupt men in the midst of their talk.
And that's the problem with the nation of Israel. We can't wait for our turn to speak. We got to say something.
You got to cut a brother off. Could be bringing out a great point with the scriptures and everything, but you don't want to hear him because you're going to cut him off before he can finish.
Well, he could just be right about the point that you were trying to strife about. He right about what you want to argue and strife about, but you can't seem to listen.
It makes no sense. it really don't, man.
Back to you, my brother.
We really got to come up out of that thing, man, because what starts strife is a man who's proud, always stirring up strife. He's too proud. He don't want to hear nothing you got to say. Proverbs 28 and 25. A proud man loves strife.
Proverbs 28 and 5. 25? You said Proverbs 28. 28 25, yeah. Proverbs chapter 28, verse 25. Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 25. He that is proud of heart stirreth up strife, but he that putteth his trust in the Lord shall be made fat.
He that is proud of heart stirreth up strife. Mm. Brother, You're proud of heart when you do not want to listen to nothing nobody got to say. You want to cut them off. You got to make your point known because you are high-minded.
Yeah.
Anything anybody else have to say really don't matter. As long as what you got to say comes out and you get your point across.
Watch this. Let me read 26. It says, he that trusteth his own heart is a fool, but whosoever walketh wisely shall be delivered. So that's going into, just like you said, he's so proud and high-minded, he only trusts his own way. He only trusts in the way of the Most High, because you can't bring that point to him.
Yeah.
He trusts in his own heart. That's why he is considered proud. So he is a fool. But at the same time, you know what that proud, the way you describe that thing to be? That could be what we also know as something called stubbornness.
True.
See, when you're stubborn, I'm going to show you something about a stubborn person. A stubborn person is headstrong.
Yeah.
They feel the way that they do things is right no matter what. You can have 10 people telling you, brother, that's not the way to come on with people. Brother, that's not the way you do that. Brother, that's not the way you deal. He will still continually do it. And you know what he'll say? They just don't like correction. Everybody will be deleting you, right? Because of the way you say something to them. They'll be deleting you.
Yeah.
He will say, he won't see that he is the problem. It'll always be them, right? That's insanity. That's what we call insanity. For you to keep doing something and getting the same results, right? You keep getting the same results, but you keep doing it expecting a different result.
True.
That's what we call insanity. But that's also stubbornness. Yeah. Now, do y'all understand what the Most High considers stubbornness?
Mm.
Let's pull that. Let me show you what the Most High considers stubbornness to be. Let's go to 1 Samuel 15 and 23. 1 Samuel chapter 15 and verse 23. We're going to find out what stubborn is according to the scriptures.
1 Samuel chapter 15 and verse 23.
Come on.
For rebellious is as the sin of witchcraft.
So rebellion, rebelliousness is witchcraft.
Mm. And stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry.
It's as idolatry.
That's crazy.
Now, we know that in the laws, it tells us that neither one of those things should be suffered to live.
Uh-huh. Jeez.
As a fact, he dismissed the northern kingdom for dealing in what?
Idolatry. True. All right.
So, back to you, brother. Back to you. I just want to bring that point out.
And you know, that was a great point, because what brothers don't understand is, man, you so busy all up in your strife, man. You really not getting to nothing. All you want to do is argue. What's the point of arguing, brother?
Yeah.
But even if a brother at peace with you, you don't want the peace.
See, I'm glad you gave me some correction today. I'm glad you made me realize my eyes, open my eyes. I'm going back and forth with brothers.
Uh-huh.
When the scriptures tell us, just go away from them.
Yeah. Because, you know, even though you can come at that brother with peace, he going to keep trying to force that strife, right? He gonna keep Proverbs 30 and 33. He gonna keep forcing. No matter how much peace, you can come to a conclusion with this brother. But the next day you watch and you get on Facebook Live, or you trying to go on YouTube, whatever, you gonna see a video of him taking a shot at you. Brother, we just came to a conclusion. We just came to peace. That's what happened?
That's why the scriptures say, pay not mind to every word spoken, lest you hear thy servant curse thee.
Yeah, true.
Now I'm paraphrasing, shooting it from the hip.
Yeah, it's true though.
But it's true.
Yeah.
We just chilling, man. We just having a good time, messing around, click on the class, brother taking shots at us.
That's forcing it, brother.
Hey,
you forcing.
Before we read that, can I read something? Because this goes right into what we're talking about.
Go ahead.
Give me Proverbs chapter 3, verse 30. This is for the brothers who just like to strive. They just like to strive.
Proverbs chapter 3. Hold on, y'all. Give me a second. Chapter 3 and verse 7.
Verse 30. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 30. I'm sorry.
Okay. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 30. Strive not with a man without cause. Dang. If he have done thee no harm, all right.
Come on. Read it over. Read it over. Right.
Strive not with a man without cause. If he have not done thee no harm.
If he ain't done thee no harm, what are you striving with him for? Why are you looking? Because we know the word strive means argument, a dispute,
uh-huh.
Things like that. So what are you arguing a dispute and a coming at brothers for if they ain't did no harm to you? That's like the brother who goes around from page to page meddling in other people's business. Just from this page to that page.
That's crazy, man. You're supposed to be doing that, man.
So what scripture you want me to read, brother?
Proverbs 30 and 33.
Proverbs chapter 30, verse 33.
Uh-huh.
Proverbs chapter 30 and verse 33. Surely the churning of milk... I'm sorry, Salaki. Surely the churning of milk bringeth forth butter, and the wringing of the nose bringeth forth blood. So the forcing of wrath bringeth forth strife. Excuse me.
See, he said, surely the churning of milk. We know back in the days they had the big wooden thing with the paddle churning the milk. That's how they got their butter, right? He said, and the wringing of the nose. You come and you wring somebody's nose, it's gonna bring blood. That's what's gonna happen. He says, and he says, I'm sorry. So the forcing of wrath bring it for you're forcing it, brother. I can be coming at peace with you. There could not be the issue could not be so big, but you're gonna force it so bad. Your wrath, you're gonna be forcing it that it's gonna bring forth strife. Now me and you, we going back and forth at it.
That's right. Because some people have to remember. The things you say can make strife.
Yes, it can.
The words you let fly out your mouth. And sometimes you can have good intentions. But true. Scriptures say the way you say things can start something too.
It's true.
Let's pull that record. Let's prove it. Let's go to, what's the scripture? I'm trying to think of it off the top. Proverbs 15 and 4. Check Proverbs 15 and 4.
Proverbs 15 and 4?
Yeah.
All right.
I ain't had that in the notes.
Proverbs chapter 15. And verse 4, that wholesome tongue is a tree of life.
No, that ain't it. Salakia, let me see something. Let me check my thing real quick. Find my scriptures. Salakia, give me a second, y'all.
You mean verse 1? I saw my answer turn away.
Yeah, give Salakia, my bad. Give me that.
Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 1. A soft answer turneth away wrath, but a grievous word stir up anger.
Okay, so let's get the understanding of that. Read it slowly this time.
Okay. A soft answer turneth away wrath.
So it's just like I was just saying before we got caught up looking for the verse. It's a soft answer can turn away wrath. Sometimes that what you say is the way you say it that makes the problem, right?
Yeah.
Okay, come on.
But grievous words stir up anger.
But them grievous words stir up anger. The way you say things, the disrespectful things you may say, you don't know. But the way you say things and the way you come off can cause a problem.
Yeah.
It can cause a problem. The scriptures, you got to know how to rebuke people. You can't just come at people any kind of way and say what you want to them. I can't come up to a sister and say, you know what, the problem with y'all women is y'all talk too much. Y'all need to learn how to shut the hell up. And not expect the answer. She may tell me, kiss her ass.
It's true.
So,
but that's why, I'm glad you said that, but that's why you have to have, you know, you got to be wise when you're using your tongue.
That's right.
You got to be super wise. That's why verse 2 say, the tongue of the wise useth knowledge aright. Absolutely. So you have to use knowledge when you're approaching people. You don't ever know what you're going to make that person say. You can set that person off, man. So, man, come on. Now, you have to... That's why the wise uses his knowledge aright. He know what to say. He going to use the scripture to say it. He said, but the mouth of fools poureth out foolishness. You don't care what come out your mouth. You just going to say it. Then when repercussion come your way, you look shocked. That is your fault, man. You cannot be doing that.
You can't just, you know, it is what it is.
That was a great scripture, man. I think people understand that thing, man. It's serious, man. Man, that's just a brother who's full of anger, though. Always ready to start something out of nothing.
Right. Right. Because, you got to remember, when you get to a person that is always strife or something,
mm-hmm.
If somebody is that easily confrontational, it ain't just what just happened. It's more going on back there.
True.
It's more. Give me James 3:16 real quick. Let's pull that.
That's true.
Let's pull that. It's always something else. It's got to be something else behind that. Brother may be in a lot more sin than just that one occasion.
True.
That's what the scriptures say. Let's read the scripture though. Let's get James chapter 3:16.
James. James chapter 3 and verse 16.
Yeah.
For where envying and strife is, there is confusion in every evil work.
So it's way more going on than just there. You know what I'm saying? Wherever envy and strife is, it's confusion and more evil works.
Yeah.
It's something else. I don't know. I mean, I've never been a person that goes to look for arguments. I've never been the one that was just confrontational.
Yeah.
Because I knew where I was going to go with it.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But now you get to the stage, okay, you're walking a little different, and then you come across brothers, older brothers, all of them. That's why that scripture say that wisdom ain't counted by days.
Mm-hmm.
By the days lived, because you can be an old fool.
It's true, though.
But these men who filled up with anger, that's what it leads to. It's a bunch of strife.
Yeah.
So I'm going to pass it back to you, Brethren.
Man, you was absolutely right about that, man. Full of that anger for what? We're going to find out Proverbs 29:22, man.
Proverbs 29 and verse 22.
Yeah, you full of this anger. So your love and your passion is to stir up strife. It makes no sense, man. You should not be wanting to start up that much strife. For what reason? It's not going to profit you nothing.
Proverbs chapter 29 verse 22. Proverbs chapter 29 and verse 22. An angry man stirreth up strife, and a furious man aboundeth in transgression.
So angry, you are angry all the time. You're full of anger, and I'm going to ask for what?
I'm going to look up this word abounded.
Oh, just please.
To make sure people understand what this is saying.
So you full of that anger. So what you're going to do is go around and start problems with brothers and sisters all day, every day, for no reason. That thing has to be cut out. It's not that serious. You got to sit back sometimes when you're doing things like that and examine yourself.
The word abound exists in large numbers or amounts.
Oh, Lord. See, that's what I'm talking about.
So, let's plug that in real quick. What scripture was that again?
Proverbs 29 and 22.
An angry man stirreth up strife, and a furious man aboundeth in transgression. He's in a multitude of transgressions.
Oh, man. No, that's why you're angry all the time. See, it's something behind you're angry all the time because you're in so much transgression, it's not funny. So what you lead to is going into strife. A lot of strife. I ain't like what he just said.
It ain't no reconciliation with brothers like that. These brothers, that, you know, you can prove pull a million scriptures to show a brother they wrong. You can even confound brothers in the conversation 4 or 5 different times.
Yeah.
And it will still do nothing. They will still go back next week and try to make a class or send some slick remarks, try to diss. And it's just, why? Because some brothers are, I use an example. You're running out of oil.
Yeah.
Running out of wisdom, right?
Yeah.
You know when somebody running out of wisdom? When you or someone else or somebody else's school always become the topic.
Yeah, true.
They have no more substance. So the only way they can produce the class is to be in the midst of strife.
Yeah.
That's why brothers are not complaining about you teaching the laws over and over and over. Anybody complaining about that? They complaining about the fact that you're complacent. Everything you do is subliminal or is derogatory to tear somebody else down. That's when people say, why y'all do the same thing all the time? Because if it becomes a pattern of all you do is talk about people, all you do is talk about this school, all you do is talk about that person. Every class is directed towards somebody at some point in stage in the class. That's when you can tell somebody is running out of oil.
Mm. Yeah, that's true.
Meaning they're running out of wisdom.
You has hit your spiritual ceiling, brother.
That's right. So when we take account of all that, we have to understand that there is no point for us to be, you know, upset or to go back and forth with these brothers because if you don't argue with them,
yeah,
they will have nothing to produce.
I'm telling you.
All right?
But when a man is full of anger and have nothing better to do, he stirs up strife, causing problems with everybody, man.
Like you just said. I'm going to read 29, 22 one more time, and then I want you to give me 22 and 5.
All right.
An angry man stirreth up strife, and a furious man abounded in transgression. Now give me Proverbs 22 and 25.
22 and 25?
Yes.
All right, Proverbs 22 and 25. Least thou learn his ways and get a snare to thy...
No.
I'm sorry.
Give me 22 and jump up to verse 24.
Okay.
That's an angry man.
Okay, 24. Proverbs 22 and 24. Make no friends with the angry man, and with a furious man thou shalt not go.
Come on.
Least thou learn his ways and get a snare to thy soul.
And get a snare to thy soul. Set a trap for your own soul. Because you rolling with this angry man who loves to be in the middle of strife, eventually what's going to happen? You're going to get pulled into that strife.
Yeah.
And then, bam.
You don't even know why you're in it.
You but can't you're go. In. Nobody said don't go with an angry man. Because an angry man will have you fighting. And at the end, you're like, what he was fighting for?
Yeah.
If you make it out to fight. And most of the time, the brother that keep up the most drumming, the other person who was just there and the one who take the worst of it.
Yeah, and it's true, man. And that's crazy, man. I'm glad you pulled that. Let's get Proverbs 15 and 18.
That's a fact.
Where do you want to go?
Let's get that. Let's get what you just called. Where we going?
Proverbs 15 and 18.
Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 18. Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 18. And it reads, a wrathful man stirreth up strife, but he that is slow to anger appeaseth strife.
A angry man stirreth up strife. So anytime you're angry, the only thing you want to do is start problems, conflicts, and you want to start strife, you want to start name calling, words, saying stuff that you should not be saying. But he said, but he that is slow to anger, he the one who is humble. He ain't really, he going to ignore a lot of those things. He is slow to anger, gonna appeaseth strife. So he gonna be ignoring that.
Right. So, matter of fact, let's take a quick break, and when we come back, it's back to getting on the strife. You know what I'm saying?
Oh yeah.
So we'll be back shortly. We'll be back shortly. Give us a moment. We'll be back shortly. Hold your voices. Don't lose your seat. We'll be right back. We'll be right back.
Hold on to your seat.
Ain't no woman like the one I got when I kiss her.
the four tops. Ain't no woman like the one I got. Hey. Shalom, Shisee. Shalom, shalom.
Shalom, brethren.
That's my brothers out there in Dallas. My brothers out there in Dallas. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Shalom, shalom. Princess and I. See you watching, baby. Shalom, shalom, baby. Shalom. You know we love you.
Oh, yeah.
You know, she dynamite to the One Nation Israelite School.
Oh, yeah.
She is dynamite. Shalom, brethren. Shalom. All right. So, before we went on break, we was bringing out strifefulness.
Yes, sir.
Why? Because after today, we just finished dealing with the strife.
It's crazy,
we
man.
We gonna keep it moving. This is let's pick up where we left off at. Let's go right back to that scripture. Let's Proverbs chapter 15 verse 18. Proverbs chapter 15 verse 18. And it reads, "A wrathful man stirreth up strife, but he that is slow to anger appeaseth strife."
So we know that wrathful man, a angry man, stirreth up strife.
Mm-hmm.
So he loved this. He loved to stir strife, start in problems all the time. He don't know, the peace is hard to find with this brother.
Right.
Because he's so wrathful.
Right.
So every time you turn around, there's strife there. There's a confliction. There's a problem with this brother.
That's right. Them brothers you always see, they always seem to miss to some type of argument. They
yeah.
Brother can't even come on a social media and you're not getting into an argument.
And that's crazy. It's crazy, man.
But you know what? Like I said, some brothers you have to just, you know, we get ignorance.
True.
That's why I'm glad I got brothers next to me and tell me, you know what? Don't even respond to them no more.
Yeah.
You said what you need to say, you killed it, you confounded it. Leave it alone. Don't argue no more.
And oh, yeah.
Oh, glory to the Father that I got brothers around me that'll tell me that.
Yeah, glory to the Father. All right? Glory to him.
So now, what's the second half of this talking about though, brethren? Well, it says, but he that is slow to anger appeaseth strife.
That's a man who, when a man who appeaseth that strife, you know, he's slow, so he ain't gonna be that quick to, when somebody say something, he ain't gonna respond to it all the time. When he appeases it, he gonna ignore it. Okay, yeah, he said that. But it's so many times that you can do that to a humble man before he strikes back.
Right.
He's gonna say something.
Right.
Remember that.
Give me Proverbs 20:3. Because when we also thinking about it was something you were just saying, it slipped my mind already, so let's just read the scripture.
Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 3.
Come on.
It is an honor for a man to cease from strife.
So it is an honor for a man to cease from strife. It is an honor for a man to avoid a fight. It is an honor for a man to leave a petty argument.
Yeah.
Come on.
But every fool will be meddling.
But a fool, a fool gonna keep going back and forth. A fool won't cease from strife. A fool will insist on meddling. A fool will continue to go back and forth. It says meddling. A fool will insist on meddling.
Yeah.
And we know what the scriptures say about meddling. Alright? So I'm gonna pass it back to you, Brethren.
That's crazy. And now that you said that, man, certain people got a problem with that thing. Some stuff do not be your business. Why you wanna go meddling in it?
Right.
Come on, Brethren. We supposed to be better than that. We supposed to be an example. But let's go and get Proverbs 16:28.
Proverbs chapter 16 verse 28.
Yeah.
Proverbs chapter 16 verse 28. As a fact.
Hold on, did I say 16:28?
Yeah.
It's my fault. Proverbs 26:17.
Proverbs chapter 26 verse 17.
Uh-huh.
Salakia, Proverbs chapter 26 verse 17.
Uh-huh.
And it reads, "He that passeth by and meddleth with strife belonging not to him, it's like one that taketh a dog by the ears."
Oh, Lord. Yeah. This brother always in somebody business. He go around there, everybody, bro, it don't belongs to you. It got nothing to do with you. Why you in somebody business? It don't pertain to you.
Y'all ever grab the dog by the ear?
He go to holler.
He either go to hollering or he try to get to you. So I'm trying to give you the example of what that's talking about.
Yeah.
When you grab a dog by the ear, not to until you get a reaction out of it.
Yeah.
All right. So read that scripture for me. I like that scripture. That's good. I like that.
Proverbs 26 and verse 17. "He that passes by and meddleth with strife belong you not to them?
See, that's that brother gonna put his soul in danger. Because it ain't got nothing to do with you. Sometimes you don't even know what's going on. So that's why I say it ain't our job to try to correct every situation. True. Because it ain't your business.
True.
Sometimes you may be sticking your nose in some deep water. And then instead of the person who was finna get shot, your ass get shot. So, sometimes it's best to just go on mind your business now. Hey man, I know I was in the world plenty of time, brother. Dude was out there arguing. He said, "Hey man, I'm gonna tell you one time, bro. Go on about your business."
Yeah.
I said, "Brother, the way he said it sounds like he's serious. Let's go."
No, man, leave that brother alone. Hey,
you wanna be Esau? Yeah, that's Esau right there. Esau right into the danger. Now what the heck is going on?
Got him running in the circle now.
So you gotta remember, man. You gotta stay in your place. Everything is not your business. As a fact, give me Sirach 11 and 10. Let's get something about meddling and stuff that don't belong to you. I like that scripture, brother.
11 and 10?
Yeah.
Sirach chapter 11 verse 10. My son, meddle not with many matters.
So meddle not with many matters, come on.
For if thou meddle much, thou shalt not be innocent.
You ain't gonna be innocent when the thing lash out. Because you wasn't involved, but you invited yourself into that situation.
Oh man.
Now it's on and popping. when the blender turned on, you can't jump out of it.
It's no escape.
So say, so don't stick your nose in other people's business, because sometimes it just ain't your business.
It's not.
As a fact, is that the end of that?
No.
Come on.
And if thou follow after, thou shalt not obtain, neither shalt thou escape by fleeing. Mm. Oh Lord.
That means you gonna get yourself in some stuff that you can't even get up out of.
Nah, man.
You get yourself in the middle of something that you ain't got no business being in the middle of, and you can't get yourself out of it now because you stuck your nose in it.
And it's your own fault.
Right? Give me a. Is that 1 Thessalonians 4 and 11? Check that real quick. Sometimes we need to apply this. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11.
1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 11.
Right.
And that ye study to be quiet.
Sometimes you need to study to do what?
To be quiet.
Be quiet.
And to do your own business.
And mind your own damn business.
It's tripping, man. It's
tripping. All right. So.
Good job, man. Man. You crazy, man.
Sometimes you just got to shut up, man. You keep sticking your nose up until you find around, mess around and catch one of them damn lump lump.
Hey, extra swole out there, man.
Hey, ain't that better than, ain't not worse than running out and shooting for bullets and you ain't having to do it.
Let's tell you, man. Woo! Trying to get up out of there, man.
Man, I'm telling you, man. I'm passing back to you, man. I'm stopped, man. I need to stop it.
I'm saying you crazy, man. But why would a man want to stir up so much strife and get in everybody's business? There's a reason. Is it because there's hatred there? Even though you want to deny there's no hatred there, what does the scripture say?
Right.
Proverbs 10 and 12.
Proverbs chapter 10, verse 12.
Uh-huh.
Hey, I want to take a break real quick. Let's let me drop the scripture and then we're going to take a quick break.
All right.
Proverbs chapter 10, verse 12. Hatred stirred up strife, but love covereth all sins.
It said hatred stirred up the strife.
Right.
So no matter you, brother, it ain't no hatred. The scriptures say hatred stirred. So that's hatred in you that stirred up that strife.
Right. Why else would you be going from this person's business to that person's business, this person's business, that person's business? You're looking for something. That's that you got evil suspicions. Right. I'm not going to look to catch you in sin. When it happens, I'll correct you.
True.
And when I do it, I'm going to come to you peacefully. Because remember, like I said, I can't come up to you and say, man, the problem with y'all women is y'all need to learn how to shut the hell up. Y'all talk too dang much.
You're going to start some.
And not expect a response.
You're going to start
some. She may tell me, kiss her ass. Just
straight
up.
Come on, man.
So, we're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back. Let me see, if y'all too young for this here, y'all may be too young for this. This may be too a little bit past y'all time right here.
Oh Lord.
Somebody kept requesting this group, so I had to play one for them.
That's the jail now. Oh man. That's the jail right there. saying right now.
Trust me, I got some more up in there,
buddy. That jam right there, bro. That jam.
They said I ain't gonna
know
about no new
person. Oh, come on, man. That jam right there.
You should have made this blind man see. I've got my pride back into my pocket. Oh, won't you bring her back?
If you know something about that right now,
well,
can I get two hearts? If you know something about that, though, I'm waiting to see. We're gonna count it down.
I don't know too many people know something about that right now.
I see one. I see. There we go. Two. Okay.
I see you.
All right.
That jam.
All right. So, okay. We gonna hold y'all much longer. We almost finished.
About
but
to wrap hey, it up.
I love doing this, man. I love it.
Of course.
Saying glory to the Father.
All glory to Him.
Alright, so let's pick up where we was at. What was the last scripture we stopped?
Last scripture we stopped on was Proverbs 10:12.
Let's start there.
I'm right. Yeah, you're right.
Let's start right there. Hatred stirreth up strife, but love covereth all sins.
love. That love. Knowing how to deal with your brother, that's love.
Right.
Knowing what to say to your brother, that's love. Knowing when to cut it off, that's love, man. According to these scriptures.
Knowing how to speak, that's love. Remember the example I give. I keep saying it because I want y'all to get it understood. Even if I call myself trying to rebuke or correct somebody, right?
Yeah.
I cannot just come to a sister and say, y'all talk too much. That's y'all issue. Y'all need to learn how to shut the hell up. Because she may tell me what? Kiss her ass. So, even when you're speaking with the women, you have to know how to speak to them. And when it comes to dealing with brothers, you need to know how to deal with them. Because your day sure not going to talk to another man a certain way and not expect a response.
I'm a grown man like you're a man. That's what you have to understand.
But you know what? The problem is, some people will not understand it. They don't have that understanding, right?
Oh, no, they don't.
Saying, some people, no matter how you deal with them, it's going to be something.
Yeah.
Because they are difficult people to deal with.
True.
So give me Proverbs 3 and 32. Let's pull that real quick. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 32.
Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 32.
And all of that is just a part of an attribute of a strifeful man.
It's crazy. Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 32. For the fourth is abomination to the Lord.
Hold on. Read that again.
For the fourth is abomination unto the Lord.
See, that word fraud means difficult. A difficult man to deal with is what? An abomination unto the Lord, right?
Uh-huh.
Come on. That's it.
But his secret is with the righteous.
And the secret is with the righteous, all right? So, what we find out, a difficult person to deal with is an abomination.
Yeah.
That's why you can't, some people, you can't deal with them without it being some kind of strife in the midst of it.
I'm glad you say that. Proverbs 16 and 28 say that.
Right. You want me to pull it?
Yeah, go ahead. Pull that.
Proverbs 16, verse 28.
Uh-huh.
A fraud man soweth strife.
What that fraud man do?
Soweth strife.
This difficult behind man gonna force strife with you no matter what. He difficult. You could have said something that was just encouraging to this brother, or y'all could have had a conversation, something was right. He, no, brother, hold up.
That's a fact. I'm glad you brought that up, because I heard a statement that was made. We do exalt brothers. We say all praise to the Most High for the brothers who keep the commandments. Every class. Is that exhorting someone personally?
No, that's not.
No, because when you call yourself trying to correct somebody, you come to them direct, right?
Yeah.
So when you're trying to exhort some, I ain't going to explain no more. Let me give an example so the brothers can get an example of what it means to exhort somebody.
Uh-huh.
Let's say you just did a class, right?
Yeah.
Just play along with me. Hey, Shalom, brother. Hey, man, that was a good class you did last week, man.
Man, I appreciate you,
man,
bro.
And that's a nice segment you got going, too. That's healthy for the nation.
Yeah, bro, you know, I'm just trying to put in work.
Man, all praise to the Most High, man.
All praises. You just gave glory to the Most High.
Hey, so.
But you exhorted me at the same time.
So when I exhort you, then I'm going to say something like, man, keep it up, man. Keep a good work up.
You're right.
That's exhorting someone, not me giving a shout out to the Most High. Okay? Now, we give glory to the Most High, of course.
All the time.
We give glory to the Most High. But if you're going to exhort someone means you have to be encouraging them.
True.
You have to be acknowledging something they're doing.
Yeah. That was the greatest. That brother broke that thing down.
All right, so when you watch this class to make your next piece to diss us, make sure you understand what exhorting somebody is.
Man. Yes, sir. Hey, man, you crazy, man.
All right. So,
oh, man.
So I'm passing back to you, Richard. Where we going?
Yeah, man. Man, caught me off guard. But that Ford man, that's so hard and difficult, man, he don't care what come out of his mouth, man. He really don't. Because he's full of anger.
As a fact, let me show you something about a fraud man. If you deal with him too long, it'll turn into something, right?
Yeah.
It'll turn into something. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 6, verse 12. Let's start at verse 12. Proverbs chapter 6, start at verse 12.
All right. Proverbs chapter 6 and verse 12. A naughty person, a wicked man walketh with a forward mouth.
A difficult mouth. He got a dirty mouth. He come at you sideways. He walk with his mouth. He don't care what come out of it, right? Come on.
He winketh his eyes He speak with his feet.
Because if you sit there arguing too long, now it's getting physical. Yeah. Say, if you keep going back and forth, now it's getting physical. He said he gonna teach with his feet, right?
Yeah.
Hold on, let me make sure he speak with his feet. All right, so come on. Now he's stumping you down. Come on.
He teaches, I'm sorry, he teaches with his fingers.
He won't get me. Hey, but what you're saying is, you can't deal with them people like that, man. Why? Because eventually, all that mouth gonna lead to them hands getting swung.
You're right.
Somebody getting stomped down.
But that's because that forwardness is in his heart.
Right.
Like verse 14 say, forwardness is in his heart. He devises mischief continually. He sows discord.
So jump down to 16 for me, since we're going to pull it out. Jump down to 16 for me.
Verse 16. These things doth the Lord hate.
Come on.
Yea, seven are an abomination unto him.
Hold on. Give me Jeremiah 44:4 to prove what abomination is before we keep going.
All right.
Jeremiah 44:4. Precept this in your Bible. This is abomination.
Jeremiah chapter 44:4.
Come on.
How be it, I sent unto you all my servants, the prophets.
The most I say, how be it, I send the prophets to you. Come on.
Rising early and sending them, saying, oh, do not this abominable thing I hate.
Do not this abominable thing that I what?
I hate.
So an abomination is something that what?
The most I hate.
All right. Let's go back to what we was. So let's start from 16 again.
These six things doth the Lord hate.
Come on.
Yea, seven are an abomination unto him.
Come on.
A proud look.
Woo!
A lying tongue.
Now, a lot of brothers got a problem with that, but we're going to deal with that on another case. Come on.
That's funny. And hands that shed innocent blood.
Come on.
And heart that devises wicked imagination.
Come on.
Feet that be swift and running to mischief.
It's a fight.
Yeah.
Come on.
A false witness that speaketh lies.
Oh, man.
And he that soweth discord among brethren.
He that do what?
And he that soweth discord among brethren.
Like a whisperer that spreadeth chief friends?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's what that is.
All right. So, now I'm going to pass it back to you. I'm slacking. I keep cutting you off.
Man, that was great. Now I can't come across these scriptures, man. That's what they're here for. Here to tear it up.
Where are we going?
And I'm glad, but all of that, just that reminds me of an angry man. He's so angry. He's full of hate. But let's see what the Most High say about somebody who's angry. Let's go to Ecclesiastes 7:9.
Ecclesiastes?
Uh-huh.
Ecclesiastes chapter 7 verse 9. Be not hasty in the spirit to be angry.
Uh-huh.
For anger resteth in the bosom of fools. Excuse me.
So be not hasty in thy spirit to be angry.
Mm.
But that's that man who always want that strife. And his spirit is full of anger. Mm. And the Most High said this about him. For anger resteth in the bosom of fools. So the Most High just said it plain and simple, you're a fool. You always with the foolishness. Why you wanna argue with me, Brethren?
Cut the malarkey, man.
Yeah. Most High just told you how it is, man.
Sometimes you brothers need to learn to shut your pie hole, man.
That's crazy, man. But that's because you full of anger, man. So you don't know nothing but strife. That's the only thing you know.
That's right.
That's the only thing you can come to.
Like I told you, when you watch certain classes. No. Well, 90% of the classes. I'm just gonna throw it away. You watch 90% of the classes. That's why you see it ain't nothing but shots being taken.
Yeah, true.
Somebody's school, somebody is the topic. It got to be somebody that is the topic.
Yeah. And that's crazy though. Man, that is right. That's crazy. But now from there, let's go to Psalms 80:6, because when you're doing that, you're off topic, man. We got a main goal, we got a main mission.
That's right.
All that strife going back and forth, man, we looking silly. Extra silly, man.
You said Psalms chapter 80, verse 6.
Yeah, Psalms chapter 80, verse 6.
What? This is the part that I people don't seem to understand.
Mm-hmm.
That while you are studying strifing with brothers who know the laws and commandments, who are trying to wake up the lost sheep, while you so focused on arguing and going back and forth with them,
yeah,
the fish that don't know are passing us by.
Yeah.
And not only are you doing that, the enemy's sitting back laughing at us. Them niggas still ain't joined together.
All day, man. We're looking foolish, man. We're supposed to be together out here waking up lost sheep. But we got our mind on strife. Yeah. For what?
Instead of worrying about waking up lost sheep, instead of strifing with your brother, let's worry about the bigger mission. But yeah, you're so busy worrying about me and arguing with other brothers and throwing this school name in class that you're missing the whole point. The enemy is sitting back laughing at us.
Yeah, man.
Let's read the scripture. Psalms chapter 80, verse 6. Psalms chapter 80, verse 6. And it reads, "Thou makest us unto our neighbors and our enemies."
Read that one more time.
I'm sorry. "Thou makest us a stripe unto our neighbors."
The Most High said he said thou. The Most High gonna make us a stripe unto our neighbors. Why? Because that's what they always seem to know. That's the only thing. You're strifing against your brethren. Like I said, we have a bigger picture. The bigger picture out there is to wake up the lost sheep. The finish line is the kingdom. But the Most High gonna make us strife against our neighbors.
Every time it look like we going forward, we drop the baton.
You can't get right, man.
So it says, "Thou makest us a stripe unto our neighbors."
Uh-huh.
"And our enemies laugh among themselves."
Oh, look at now, look at them niggas over there.
Niggas ain't got together yet.
They can't agree on the same thing. The laws and commandments, they can't even agree on that.
Right. That goes to when you think about them curses, man. That astonishment. Give me that Deuteronomy 28:37. That's an astonishment, man. That's an astonishment right there.
Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse 37.
Right.
"And thou shalt become an astonishment, a proverb, and a byword among all nations, whether the Lord shall lead thee."
Now, let's break that thing down.
Uh-huh.
Come on.
"And thou shalt become an astonishment."
I'm going to deal with the astonishment in a sec. It's an astonishment to see the way that we deal with each other. How we are so busy targeting each other and being in so much strife with each other that we can't even get to the main goal. The enemy is sitting back laughing at you. And astonishment is something that's amazing to look at. Wow, look at them niggas. They still ain't figured it out yet.
Yeah.
These brothers say they know the Bible and they're still going back and forth with each other.
Yeah.
Y'all are in astonishment, right? Come on.
A proverb. Man, don't you know that one of the proverbs I heard is if you put two black men in the same room, they can't get along with each other?
Right. They say put two women, if you want to see a fight, put two black women in a room.
That's crazy. That's a proverb.
Niggas don't want to read.
Put something in the book.
Hey, nigga don't know a scripture, but he know the Beyonce song.
That's crazy.
Right? So that's a proverb and an astonishment. Now give me the next one.
And a byword.
Because you still don't seem to realize. Even though you say you're an Israelite, you know you're an Israelite, you still don't know because you're still not applying what applies to us.
True.
You're still not applying what applies to us. So, yes, we still fit the by words. Let's precept that real quick. Give me Psalms 44:14.
Psalms 48:14?
No, 44:14.
My fault. Psalms 44:14.
Mark that in your Bible if you ain't got it, brother. That's a precept for you.
I went to the bottom of my head like, what is that, though?
Psalms 44:14.
Psalms 44:14. "Thou makest us a byword among the heathen."
And what else?
Woo! "A shaking of the head among the people."
You know what that's talking about? You know when you look at somebody and it's a shame, right? You be like this.
Shaking your head.
That's what that's talking about. That's that astonishment.
So that's where they get that shaking my head from.
I'm nodding your head. Look at these niggas.
Man.
Shaking his head. You got two on one. You got your byword and astonishment in that one right there. That's your precept. You can have that one. I got a lot more.
That's beautiful.
Right? All right? So, Deuteronomy 28:37. You can precept that to Psalms 44:14.
That was beautiful right there.
All right.
That's some of that good milk.
Yeah, man. When you go back to the streets, I want to hear you pull it.
I'm going to pull this.
All right.
That thing beautiful.
So back to my brethren. We almost finished. We almost out of here.
This is going to be our last scriptures, brothers and sisters.
No. Matthew is always the last.
Oh, I'm sorry. This is going to be one of my scriptures before we close it out with Matthew 26. We need to be like our forefathers, man.
Matter of fact, let me get a scripture and then you pull that one.
All right, go ahead.
Let me get Romans 16 and 17.
Romans 16 and 17.
I believe that's what I'm looking for.
All right, let me go there. We'll go ahead and get that real quick.
That's what I'm looking for, okay? Because the point is, after all this that we went through, how do we avoid dealing with brothers that's full of strife? Mm. We're not to go back and forth with them because they ain't going to get nowhere. You can't beat a negative person. You can't discipline or chastise a negative person with negativity.
It's true.
So it's only one way we can do it because we can't scoop down to their level, right?
Yeah.
We got to still let our light shine regardless.
Yeah.
So what do we do next then? Come on.
Romans chapter 16 and verse 17.
Come on.
Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned.
And do what?
And avoid them.
Because a strifeful man, 9 to 10, he's going to go against the doctrine. Everything that's going on and that he's contrary to it.
And that's crazy.
So the doctrine is this. The doctrine is the scriptures. The doctrine is the scriptures. So being a person that starts strife is contrary to the scriptures.
I mean, you can find every single problem with a brother when it comes to the scriptures.
He need to be marked.
That's crazy. What you arguing about scriptures for? Come on, bro, that's crazy. Man, get that thing together, man. That spirit is wicked.
So, sowing in discord, being a brother that loves strife, is contrary to the Bible. So what we do when we come across some type of brother? We mark them and then do what?
Avoid them.
Avoid them. All right, so what's your last? Give me a scripture, brother.
Genesis 13 and 8. Because we must be like our forefathers. But we can't do that because we can't come to peace with each other. Abraham, we must be like Abraham and Lot. Listen to what Abraham said to Lot.
Genesis chapter 13, verse 18. Genesis chapter 13 and verse 18. Then Abraham removed his tent and came and dwelt in the plain of, hold on, what scripture was that?
I mean, Genesis 13 and 8. I said 18 then.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Genesis chapter 13, verse 8. Genesis chapter 13, verse 8. Abraham said unto Lot, let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, and between my herdmen and thy herdmen, for we be brethren.
Why we can't cut a peace like that in the nation of Israel?
Right.
Did you hear what the forefather said to Lot?
Right.
That thing is serious, man.
Right.
He wanted peace. Let's stop this strifing, man. Between us and our herdsmen, we got a bigger picture. We got a bigger mission. We are brethren, man.
Right.
Like the scripture say, that's why Zephaniah 2 and 1 say, gather yourselves together. O nation, not desire. Come on, man. Right, that was another example of it. But come on, man.
So what we need to do is we need to think about the way we're moving and the way we act towards each other, the way we deal with each other. And if you got a brother that's walking contrary to how the scripture say we need to move, sometimes you got to mark that brother and let him go.
And avoid him.
Sometimes you got to let him go.
And stop dealing with him, man. There's always going to be problems there.
Right.
No matter what, there's going to be a problem there.
Right. So, when you think about that,
yeah.
Sometimes you just got to mark brothers and let them go.
It's true.
Sometimes a brother can be reproved, but even then, especially after the second and third try, let them go.
True.
All right. So, we just choose to, you know what, let brothers go. Because half the brothers that do all that striping and targeting the prophets and stuff, they ain't putting in no work. They ain't going to the front. They ain't going to the front line out on the streets and teaching like the scriptures say to them. That's why they sit behind the computer and feel comfortable and send diss shots at the prophets that are actually putting in the work.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's what we got to do, man. We just got to keep it moving, man. We just got to keep it moving. All right. So let's go to Matthew 26. Matthew 26 and verse 6. And you can tell these brothers ain't really putting out no work and stuff because these brothers. Let me block this dude. Go ahead and read it.
All right. Matthew chapter 26 and verse 6. Now when Jesus was in Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, there came unto him a woman having an alabaster box of very precious ointment, and poured it on his head as he sat at meat. But when his disciples saw it, they had indignation, saying, to what purpose is this waste? For this ointment might have been sold for much and given to the poor. When Jesus, Jehoshaphat, understood it, He said unto them, why trouble ye the woman? For she hath wrought a good work upon me. For ye have the poor always with you, but me you have not always. For in that she hath poured this ointment on my body, she did it for my burial. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached in the whole world, there shall also that this woman have done be told for a memorial of her.
Explain that real quick.
So no matter where we go and do this work, Yahushua said what this woman have done should be told for memorial of her. So that means you women are important as well in this truth. So you're more than just what the brothers say. They more than just what? Head witches, bread makers.
Bread breakers, yeah.
So you're more than that, sister. So keep your head up and play your part in this truth and be diligent with it. So
wherever we go, we are commanded to mention what the sister did preparing Christ for his burial. So with that being said, we might as well remember what it is we're supposed to be doing. What is the mission?
Wake up this lost sheep.
As a fact, give me Colossians 1:25.
Gotcha.
Because we already read the scriptures out, so we can just I just pull the scripture real quick.
All right.
Give me that real quick.
Colossians 1.
I'm Helen Mirren.
Yeah, Colossians, I believe it's 1:25.
Colossians chapter 1, verse 25. Whereof I am made a minister.
Right.
According to the dispensations.
Come on.
Of God.
Dispensation.
Oh, I'm sorry. Dispensation of God.
So read from the top.
Wherefore I am made a minister.
So all of us who are in the streets, us prophets that are woke up and understand who we are, that are teaching laws, statutes, and commandments. Now we are made up. We are made ministers. Come on.
According to the dispensation of God.
Come on.
Which is given to me for you. To fulfill the word of God.
Come on. So that means we are to go out and hit the streets and teach our people to wake up the lost sheep, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So we got a dispensation of time. Meaning we got a certain time period to put in this work.
True.
Time ain't going to be forever. The Most High ain't dealing. The wrath is coming.
He ain't playing.
The wrath is coming. You brothers better get yourself together and stop playing with it.
Yes, sir.
Get yourselves together and stop playing with it, man. All right. So with that, we're going to say Shalom. I hope this segment was good to you.
Shalom, Shalom.
Video again when I catch you. Keep open to the video, man.